Welcome everyone. I'll be telling you about publishing papers and writing papers, and of course everybody knows the publish or perish infamous statement, and so the idea here is hopefully after you hear this you will not perish, you'll be publishing papers. This is the outline of the talk today. I'll start with some general thoughts about publishing papers, etc. Then I'll have a section on putting together paper, how to put paper together. Then some words about writing skills and what you need to do to improve your writing skills. And then finally, a few words about dealing with editors, reviews, etc. First, a disclaimer. I always do this. I don't claim that what I will talk about is the only way to write papers, but I claim that it is one way that does work. So this method has worked for me, has worked for my dad, and it's a very straightforward and very rational way of approaching writing papers, but obviously there's many other ways of doing it. That's definitely not what I'm claiming here. But I think if you follow the tips and the approach, the strategy that I'll be talking about, then you can really put papers together in the least painful way possible. So all the general thoughts about publishing, this is clearly the last step in a scientific project. You start the project, you have some ideas, you may have funding, you may write a proposal, etc. You do the science, you get all these results. But the last part is to communicate these findings to the broader scientific community, and then you do that by writing this work. So one of the important point to keep in mind, if you actually do a project, you generate a lot of results, you have all these experiments, etc., but you don't publish it, in my view, the whole thing has failed. All that work you put in has completely failed because you have not been able to communicate this information to other scientists in the standard way by which we communicate science. So really, if you think about any experiment you've done that has been successful but has not been published, is essentially total failure. The whole thing has not been completed. And I can say now, I'm getting old enough, I guess, that I can say from my experience that many more people can do the science than actually write the science and turn it into papers. There's really a few people that can write good, clear, concise papers, and we often see that also in the literature. We read a paper, you're like, what the heck is this about? And so it is, I think, a fact that this is one of the most critical limiting factors in a career. And I have this video that I showed to my lab a few years ago. I like to show this because really not writing your papers is the same as this. It's the same as basically, you know, playing some really fantastic football, having really great setups, and then completely failing to score a very easy goal. Because you've done all the hard work, you've done all the research, you've worked hard and generated all this fantastic data, but you're not actually writing it, you're not publishing it. It's just the same as this. Writing papers is probably the most critical, most important medium through which you communicate your science to the community. It's the durable thing, we all know it. If you want to retrieve information, just go to the literature, do PubMed search, whatever, pull out the information. Frequently we go back to papers that are 30 years old. This is what's durable, this is your legacy will be through your papers. And so it's very important to really take that extremely seriously. The purpose is to communicate your work to others, so that's obvious. So what's not always obvious is that the answers to these questions have to be very, very clear in your paper. They shouldn't be hidden there. The reader should not be digging through the discussion and stuff to find out really what the answers to these questions are. So what did you discover? What's the new information? What does it mean to the rest of the scientific world? What are the implications of your work? Fine, you have some results, but what are the implications? What does this mean for the future? And really, why should the reader care about this paper? Why should they even bother to read it? The answers to these questions have to be very clear, crystal clear in your paper. And also, before I get to the how to put the paper together and all that, this is a common misconception in my view about writing papers. I really struggle with this with people in my lab. This is always a struggle to get people to accept this simple fact that, and I can tell this again by experience, writing good papers is absolutely not about being a good writer. Okay? It has nothing to do with being an excellent writer. You can be, have excellent writing skills, excellent English skills, English writing skills, but this has nothing to do with that. And I can say that. I'm personally not a native English speaker, so I have issues with being a good writer. Frequently, I struggle with writing, and I'm not really sure if it's the way to write it or not, etc. But writing good papers is first and above all about being able to organize and present your research in a clear and rational fashion. You have to be able to tell a story. You have to be able to disconnect yourself from the history of the project. This is a very important aspect of writing papers. And you have to be also able to know what is new. What actually did you discover that is new? And how are you're contributing to the field? And what the implications of these findings are. Okay? If you can actually do this, the writing part becomes really easy. If you can actually really appreciate what is new and put it into a story that is logical and rational, then the writing part is actually the easiest part. This is the hardest part of putting paper together. And another aspect I'd like to cover is that writing paper is definitely not a mystery, writing mystery novel. Okay, so if you want to write mystery novels, do it, fine, but it has nothing to do with scientific papers. You have to say who did it immediately. It has to be very clear from the title, the abstract. It has to be very clear what the key findings are. The reader doesn't need to dig through the literature. It's getting worse and worse. I mean, we're flooded now with literature. It's so accessible, and actually I don't think we read the papers as deeply as we used to in the pre-internet age. Now everything is electronic, people tend to scan through things, so the findings, the key points have to be very obvious. And so the answers to these questions, the why, how, and what, this is really has to be very, very obvious to the readers from the get-go. And this relates to the impact of your papers. This relates to how people will actually extract information from your papers and use them. If you give them the answers very clearly, they will actually be interested in your paper, they will cite it, they will learn something from it without spending too much time on it. So I'll get back to this later, but these are some of the questions. Some of this, I always like to think of this why, how, and what. These are questions that have to be very obvious in your paper, and you have to also be very obvious in your mind before you start writing the paper. You have to know the answers to these questions without any hesitation. You should be able to answer them. And if you have the answer to this question, then it's a lot easier to write the paper. So why did you do it? Why did you do this stuff? Why did you work so hard to get the data? Why should the reader care about this paper, not another one? You have to really put things into context. Appreciate what the past is, what has been produced in science so far, and what's really new in this work. How did you do it? You have to identify the key important details, and you have to communicate clearly without just writing a thesis. Writing papers is not about writing a thesis. Sometimes some of the details are better kept to the supplementary or better done by citing other papers. So you don't need to drown the readers in all sorts of unnecessary details. And then finally, what did you find? What new information was generated by your work? How does it relate to previous knowledge? What are the implications of your finding? Again, this is really important aspect of writing a paper if you want to have a broad impact with your research. So it's not always the case, but mostly the answers to these questions are found in the different sections. The why is usually in the introduction. The how you did it is in the results. And what did you find is in the discussion, of course, sometimes in the results. Okay, so now that was a bit of long introduction and some general thoughts about writing papers. Now I have a new section in this talk which is about the more organized way of putting paper together, and I have to thank my lab for this because we had this exercise when we had the retreat last October, and we actually went through the process of putting a paper together as a group, and this helped me actually organize this process a little better, and they gave me feedback on that. So essentially this is in order, in the order of how things should really happen in my view. The first two points are absolutely critical. If you cannot do this, this is actually the hardest part too. This is the part that really is essentially the birth and the birth of the paper. And so the first thing that's in my view really important is if you want to be productive and effective, you really should integrate your research with the publication plan. So you should not wait until you've done the research and you completed all the experiments, then think about what the paper should be. You should already, once you start having some interesting and promising results, you should start making outlines and thinking about what the paper can be about, etc. So that's one important point. The second point is the outline. I love outlines, as you can ask anyone in my lab. I'm totally obsessed with outlines. I'm continually asking for outlines, revising outlines, etc. So the outline is a really important part of the paper. In particular, I like this, what I call a storyline, which is essentially very brief paragraphs that tells what the paper will be about. Once you've done this, then you get to the results. Then you'll find out in a moment what your mission should be then the introduction, then the discussion, then finally release the abstract. Okay, the title is there, but actually, you know, the title is usually, by the time you get there, the title is pretty obvious. But this is the order of things, at least how I like to do it, and starting from the outline and ending with the abstract. So let's go through this one by one. So first of all, the integrated research publication plan. In my view, this is the key to publishing lots of papers. So if you want to be productive, publish lots of papers, you need to be very organized while you're doing the research. The reason is very simple. The biggest challenge we all face is managing our time. So you continuously have conflicting experiments, right? You have a long list of things you can do, but in reality you cannot do all of them probably, and you have to really decide on how to prioritize your time. If you already have the outline of your paper clear, you can actually use that as a way to prioritize your time. So you're now much more efficient because you're saying, okay, I just need to do this one experiment, then this paper will be finished. And so that experiment should really have higher priority over everything else because that's going to get me paper within the next few months. And if you don't have that integration, then you'll be doing a lot of work. You might be prioritizing for the wrong reasons. So it's critical to actually have the integrated plan to help you be more efficient and more effective in managing your time. So essentially, prepare an outline while you're doing the experiments. So the reason I gave you is to be efficient. There's other reasons. One is also then you find out what's missing while you're actually doing it. If you do all your research, you finish, now you sit down and say, write your thesis or whatever, or now you finish your postdoc and you've gone somewhere else, you might realize that there's one really obvious experiment that is completely missing, and without it, the paper is not complete. And so now you have a problem because you finished doing the experiment, and you're maybe long gone, and that experiment is totally required to actually have a paper. So this happens a lot if you delay the outlining and drafting the paper to the end. And then this is something I actually like, and I think for me, getting older and having this age where we're flooded with information, it's actually really important to be organized. And I like the idea of having a document with an outline and a folder in my computer about that particular project, where I can just dump everything that is relevant to that topic. So you might already have an outline in your mind about a certain story, and then you might be hearing a seminar or discussing with someone. They might give you an idea that will be, oh, you think, oh, that's a really nice topic for discussion for this paper. And now you have a document where you can just go and either quickly type what the idea is or save the document or something like that. So essentially use it as a way to collect information about that topic and that paper over a long period of time, rather than sort of keeping that again until the last moment where you're sitting now in front of a blank page and thinking, what topic should I have for the discussion of this particular article? If you do it over a longer period of time and start saving things, you have some material to work with. And I personally like to operate like that, and I like to even sometimes write short paragraphs about the topic while I'm hearing about it, while I'm thinking about it, even though I may not use it before a year or two. So I like the idea also of having a document and having already folder in your paper, in your computer about that particular project, that particular paper. Okay, so now the outline. Again, I love the outlines, and this is something you really should do while you're doing the experiment. The outline, I mean, the storyline is the key part of the outline. So this is where you basically write what the paper should be about in one short paragraph, and it doesn't matter if it's properly written or not. It's irrelevant. You could write it in Spanish and translate it to Google Translation. That's fine with me. The point is you want to have the story. The storyline, how you start, what is the question, what you did, and what you found, and what the implications are, and kind of in a very brief way. So the idea is to really turn your research into a story, not just dump everything you did in the kind of just like, okay, we just did this, this and that. You want to have a story, you want to have a question, you came up with some experiments to answer that question, you found this, and those are the conclusions. So the storyline is a really important part of the outline for me, and kind of the first thing. And we now, I'm also in the last few years, we've been having a lot of meetings in the lab where we have a group of people, including people that are not involved in the project, where we bring them in. It's allowed to be very useful to do that, where you bring someone who's not associated to the project and you start brainstorming about what would be the best storyline for a given paper. And it's good to have outsiders because they have a different perspective. They're not, their mind is not corrupted by the history of the project, if you like, and think about what's the best angle to actually put this paper together. So storyline is very important. And then after that, what you want really is a list of titles of the result sections, so you can decide, okay, these are the 6-7 result sections I will have. List them, decide on their titles, and then what are the figures and tables that correspond to each one of these result sections. Right. So for me, that's a good outline. A good outline is a storyline, a paragraph about what the paper is about, then the list of results, and each one is associated with some figures or tables. Okay. And if you have that, and let's say half of them are completed, and the other half are kind of experiments you may realize, okay, I really need to do this, need to do that. Then you're really in a good shape to, while you're doing the research, you're in very good shape now. The paper is coming together, you have a vision for the paper, you're in very good shape to go back to the lab and just basically check all the boxes and complete all these experiments. So this is why I say, before I get to that, a little warning here. This business of integrating the research with the outline and with the publication planning process, of course, should not mean that you become dogmatic and you forget that, you know, you're doing science and everything is dependent on the experiment. So that doesn't mean that you should become wedded to your outline. And so the outline is not a way of saying, this is it, this is the story, no matter what, this would be the paper. The outline is something that's very flexible. You put it together once you start having some promising results. You go through the experiments, and of course sometimes, actually frequently, as we know, the results don't match what you're expecting, and now you go back and make another outline. Trust me, I have tons of things in this computer, tons of outlines that will never be published, and really, I wish they were true, but they didn't pan out. So that's a little warning that should be obvious to everyone. Okay, so the outline also is, how do you do it? How do you put an outline together? How do you put a storyline together? Well, you could do it the boring way, as we discussed in my group. See me laughing there in the back. So you can do it the boring way, and the boring way is really the most boring way, is the historical way. Okay, so this is how you actually done the experiment historically. And there's very few papers out there that actually are published, good papers, that are really following the historical order of the experiment. Frequently, and that's the nature of science, science is just unpredictable by definition, especially if you're doing really cutting-edge science. I mean, if it was predictable, why should we do it, you know? We know the answer. So it's very unpredictable. So you might start with something like, you might start with, I don't know, an effector that has a nuclear localization signal. You make a few fusions. You test it, you expect it to be nuclear localized, but turns out to be in the membrane. Right? You're not going to write that in the paper. You're not going to say, oh, we started this because we want to find out if it's nuclear localized. We found it in the membrane. So you know, it's how you did it historically is actually relevant. Okay. So the paper doesn't have to follow the historical order of the experiment. And this is a fantastic quote, a little article. It's online, actually, if you want to dig it out. This is the time when, I guess, scientists gave talks on the BBC, which is very surprised by that. 1964, talk on the BBC. This is really a fantastic little view on this. And so what Peter Medawar said, he said that the paper, this scientific paper, is a fraud. not in the sense that it's, you know, presenting fraudulent data, but that it's never or rarely reflecting how the science was actually done. The science is done in a very messy way. You know, we have stuff, we have ideas. You go in the lab, and sometimes you discover stuff by chance or whatever. And then we try to put together in this very nice and very clean story, right? So in that sense, the scientific paper is a fraud. There's nothing wrong with that. It's better to communicate that way than to give the historical ways. Sometimes the historical ways may be fun as an anecdote to have when you're at the bar, but not really when you're trying to communicate science. So that's something that's very important to appreciate, and actually something that is extremely difficult to do. It's very difficult for the person who's been doing the science, who's been doing the research, who's really thinking about how it was done historically, to take that step back and think about presenting the story differently, sometimes in a very dramatically different way from how it was actually initially performed. Okay, so another somewhat boring way, I would say, so not maybe not as boring usually as the historical process, but this is when you really frame the paper around some generalities. You feel like, well, XLI effects are important, therefore we studied them and we found this. So that's kind of okay, but it's not really great, especially if you want to get people outside your field to be excited. They're not sort of, they think our XLI effects are exciting, they would be excited by this anyway, but if they're not really interested in that, it's kind of limited interest. So if you want to target the broadest audience possible, you really should not approach it like that. Or for example, in plant pathology, lots of papers start with, you know, phytophthora infestans is an important pathogen, therefore we study it, and then you did something with it. So that's okay, but it's not really the most exciting way to do that. So my suggestion is always keep that as a last resort. If you really cannot have any better ideas, then maybe do it that way. But if you can, then do it the inspired way. And the inspired way is to really start with a question or problem. Okay. So what is the biological question? What is the problem? What is the unknown that your data is contributing to? Okay. So rather than starting from these generalities, you start with the question, and ideally that question should be quite broad and quite general. And then you explain how your research findings are contributing new information to this problem. Okay. So in my view, this is really the first step in putting together a great paper. If you want to put a great paper together, you have to identify this unknown, this question, this problem, and have it very clear in your mind how you contributed to that. So why did you do it, and what did you find? These are actually the two very clear questions, and these are the two questions that if you cannot answer them immediately, if this is not clear in your mind, then you really have a problem in putting that paper together. It's going to be really tough to put that paper together. But if it's very clear for you why you did it and what you actually found, then it's going to be very easy to put a good paper together. And so it's all about thinking outside the box. And this is often the problem, because sometimes these questions, why did you do it and what did you find, have actually nothing to do with the historical process of how you actually did the project. Like as I said, you may have started with the idea of finding nuclear localized effectors, but you end up in a completely different direction where now you're finding effectors that are in the membrane or wrapped around host or something like that. So now you have to really take a step back and think like, okay, forget about all the nuclear stuff. I have to frame my story from a different angle. So this process actually of thinking outside the box and disconnecting yourself from the history of the project is a really, really tough challenge. And this is why I think recently I'm finding this sort of group dynamic of bringing several people to discuss about this, how do we frame a paper, is actually extremely useful, because you get people that are not contaminated, if you like, by the history of the project, that are thinking about the data in a very clear and disconnected way. Okay, so this is an example of a storyline. I think I used this last time, but it's just to show you one simple example of storyline, which is sufficient. I mean, so this is actually effective translocation inside host cell. Then the question is, do they localize subcellular compartments to alter immunity? We performed the computational screens for these effectors in nuclear localization signals. 16 candidates were identified and localized. One of these was investigated in more details. Knockdown resulted in reduced virulence. Ectopic expression resulted in altered gene expression. our findings indicate that similar to bacterial pathogens or mice secrete effectiveness manipulate host transcription to alter immunity. So this is a pretty straightforward paper, nothing exciting, but once you have a storyline like that, you really have defined sort of the way you're framing this paper, and it's very easy to go and fill in the blanks and complete it. And this is an old one, but you know, think about this maybe 4 or 5 years ago. This would have been, this is something we never published, but this would have been a really cool paper at the time, and quite nicely framed and addressing some specific questions. Okay, and so in relation to this, I also like to show this slide because the key also to the storyline is less is more. Okay, so the paper often benefits a lot by having things removed from it that are distracting from that answering that main question and the key findings. Right. So there is again that's kind of an artifact of the history, an artifact of your emotional attachment to all the experiments you've done and all the time you spend in the lab. You want to dump everything in the paper because I spent 3 months doing this stuff, right? But you really have to be able to disconnect yourself from that and think about it in a non-emotional way. What is the paper about? What would be ideally the best way to frame the paper? And what I should put in it? And avoid distracting the reader with experiments that have nothing to do with that. So if it's all framed around one topic, then it's a lot more powerful. I will have much more impact with your readers. If you start distracting them with side experiments just because you know you have the data, then that's gonna hurt the paper in my view. Okay, so now the mission, okay? So now you've done the outline, you framed your paper, you discussed it with your coworkers, you have the list of results, the list of figures, half of them are done, few are not done. Now it's the mission. Okay, this is what I like to call the mission. Once we all agree on that, then now it's very easy. You go back to the lab and you do the experiment and you generate final publication quality figures and tables, right? So this is really great. I think this is, once you have that outline, it's very easy now. You just have to just go and do the experiment. And this is also actually a very important part of the process of putting paper together. So learn to use Adobe Illustrator or whatever program you use in your group to put figures together. This is a very important part of that. Understand what the formats are. Typically, most journals have two formats for figures, either one column or two columns, so 8 or 16 centimeters. Appreciate that. Start putting together drafts of the figures. Okay? You have the list now, so it's pretty easy. Make sure that your experiments are done in as publication quality experiments, where all the controls are there, your Western blot has the proper length, the order of lanes is logical and everything. Okay, so don't use, you know, bad pictures. If you have bad pictures or out of focus images, then make new ones, you know. And learn this. This is very important, actually. This is the process of putting together outstanding, beautiful, clear figures is not easy and something you have to work on to learn how to do it. And so go and I'm sure all of you have seen papers that you really liked and you thought, wow, these figures are really smashing, then learn from that. You know, just be inspired from that to put together excellent figures. But this is the mission. This is a period that sometimes last year, sometimes last few months, but from the time you have now defined what the paper is about, you have a list of results, list of figures, you're on this mission, and hopefully it won't be impossible. Okay, so now you've done it. Now you have the outline, you have the figures, you have the figures tables. Now you start writing. Okay, in my view, this is the point where you start writing the results. You don't start writing before you have the final figures. You can draft some things if you want, but you don't really start writing the results until you have the final figures. And the reason for that is if you start doing it, you might actually write some really nonsense stuff. And I have reviewed papers like that where they talk about something in the results. You go look at the figure and it's not there, or it's different, or it looks different. Because in your mind you think, okay, you think there is a band, but in the figure you're showing the band is very weak or something. And so you have a disconnect now between what you're describing in the figure, what you're writing about it, and what's actually in the figure. So in my view, you really want to finish everything. Have your high quality publication ready figures before you start writing the results. Now it's very easy to write them because now you just basically put that figure in front of you and now you write the result section corresponding to that figure. Okay? It's pretty straightforward. You're supposed to describe what's in that figure, right? Of course, you know the conclusion. Your figure has to be representative of what the experiment is, but now it's pretty straightforward to do that. So, so the results should describe what's in your figure tables, not some other stuff that's in your mind or whatever. And, of course, the figures and tables have to represent what the experiment is about and what the point is. And you can complement this, of course, with additional information. So what I'm saying here, I'm not saying that you should not mention anything that's not in the figure. Of course, you should mention that if necessary. But you have to first describe what's in the figure. That's really clear. So, but these are the kind of things that can be mentioned, replications, sometimes data not shown, although many journals now don't accept that, statistical evaluations, etc. So this is an example of a result section which is describing what's in the figure but adding some additional information. I really like this particular style because it's the most accurate way to describe the experiment. So in this case, okay, northern blots were performed, significant induction was observed at 48 hours, so that's what's in the figure, right? So the figure shows that. And then you say independent replication of the time course suggested that the induction is significant and reproducible, but the timing varied between 16 and 48 hours. Okay. So that's a very accurate, very honest, very proper way of describing the experiment without confusing the reader, right? So you can see how if you know this, you might actually say here, like, it was observed between 16 and 48 hours. Then the reviewer will look at your figure and say, oh, it's only induced at 48 hours. Why are you saying it's induced at 16 hours? You might be tempted to say, okay, I'll just remove the 16 hours. And then 2 years later, you have to follow up on this paper and you find out where it's induced at 16 hours most of the time. How I'm going to get around that? I published it's only induced 48 hours, you know. So it's, this is the proper way of describing an experiment. Describe what's in the figure, and if there's additional information, just mention it. Nothing wrong with that. You just mention the variability of the experiment. So I like the idea of describing what's in the figure, and then if necessary, have a little few sentences afterwards to describe the reproducibility and the variability of the experiment. Nothing wrong with that. There's not an example, actually, I added, I was just thinking about when I was putting this together, because this is an example where this is the work of Joran Boss from 2006. So at that time, we had this observation that AVR3A suppresses the set death caused by informed. So this is AVR3AKI. It suppresses informed, but the EM version of AVR3A did not suppress informed. Right? So we published this figure, and we concluded that KI suppresses the informed, but EM does not. Now, when we did all these experiments, Joran did this experiment, then she realized that there's actually a lot of variability in this experiment. This is the conclusion we settled on. But there was a lot of variability in that experiment, so we decided, you know, the best way to do it is to publish this, conclude what we decide to conclude from the data, but also add a panel B to the figure, which describes the variability of the experiment. And if you look at this now, you realize that indeed it is variable. Clearly, KI is a much better suppressor than EM, and this is really representative of the typical panel we see. And, but you can see here that EM actually is also doing something to inform. It's not completely identical to inform. There is some degree of suppression that EM is doing. It's kind of intermediate. We decided to conclude at the time that KI suppresses, EM doesn't. But by including this panel B here, we really covered ourselves for future experiments. We honestly described the variation in the experiment. This doesn't affect anything. AVR3A is still suppressing inform. This doesn't affect the conclusion. But later on, and several years later, when Joran discovered that AVR3A stabilizes CMPG1, which is important for suppression of inform, she found that both KI and EM are actually able to stabilize CMPG1 to some degree. Right? So if we didn't publish this, if we only published this part, she would have been really in trouble in explaining that experiment. Why would EM then stabilize CMPG1 if it cannot suppress inform, right? So by actually showing the variability in the experiment, we could go on and continue with the science and basically say later on that, well, both KI and EM suppress CMPG1, but we do see a difference, so this is not completely crazy because EM does have some degree of suppression of inform, etc. So We just, this is how science proceeds. At the time we conclude that Ki is a very strong capacity, M is not, but this has evolved with the science. But because we put this panel, we could be, you know, we could follow up with great confidence without sort of getting us stuck and trying to sort of go back and you know, recover our tracks and everything. So this is actually a proper way of doing it. So describe what's in your results. If you have variability, describe it. Okay. Okay, the results paragraph, now the writing business. So you're writing results paragraph. For me, this is very straightforward. I have a template for this. This is a template I follow, and it's pretty easy. Sometimes, not always, but sometimes you could start with one sentence, maybe two, of introductory material to start to introduce what you're doing in that results paragraph. Okay. But please don't put a whole paragraph of introduction, okay? If you're putting a whole paragraph of introduction, then that belongs in the introduction, okay? That's how I see it. You shouldn't really put more than a couple of sentences of introduction material. If you're going to start describing, for example, what AVR3, AKI, and EM are, etc., that's the wrong place to do it. You should just put that stuff in the introduction. So one sentence is okay, one couple of sentences of background is fine. And then this is how I like to start my results paragraph. I like to start them pretty straightforward. It's boring because it often starts the same way, but that's fine. To do this, we did that. Okay. So to identify whether AVR3A suppresses INF1, we co-expressed the two proteins in Bentamiana, something like that. So that's a very simple way to do it, and it's. I think when you give the background, they explain the reason why you did the experiment, it makes it a lot easier for the reader to follow actually the flow and understand why you're actually doing this experiment and how it relates to the previous stuff. So I like to start that this way. I don't really think about too much. The results for me start with to do this, we did that. And then a useful way to approach it is first you describe the experiment in general terms. So overall experiments, we use agroinfiltration of fluorescence intact proteins followed by microscopy to determine the localization of this effect or something like that. Or we did southern blots to look at the number of copies of this gene in the genome, something like that. So it starts with general terms. And then this is, for me, also important process. Describe first the most important findings. Okay. You often have controls and stuff like that. Don't start with that. That's a mistake I often see. People start with the controls, they're already flooding you with all this details. Start with the most important finding you have from your experiment. Like, for example, in this case, a new KEX localized to the nucleus, something like that. And then start talking about GFP, where GFP localizes, where your controls localize. You know, keep that to the end rather than starting with that. So it's a very simple process. And then the last sentence, you finish your conclusion, your result paragraph with a conclusion, with a concluding statement, saying, for example, our results indicate that new KEX accumulates in plant nuclei. So it's a very simple process, not rocket science. You're not writing creative literature here. You're writing something that has to be very clear for the readers. Just follow this process, step by step, and it makes it less painful to actually write the paper together. So you put the figure in front of you, and you just follow this particular process. One introduction, if you need to, one sentence of introduction. To do this, we did that, what the general experiment is, the important findings, the controls, and then the concluding statement. And if you do that for each paragraph, then the paper is really easy to flow and easy to read. Okay, so now the introduction. So that's the next part. So for me now, you have your outline, you have your results, you have your figure, you wrote all the results. Now you get busy with the introduction. Okay. So in the introduction, in my view, there's two topics that need to be covered. The first one is why you did this work. Okay. And the second one is the background information that the readers need to understand your paper. So the key here is structure, okay? So I'll talk about this later. The structure is really important. So assign topics to each paragraph, outline your introduction, different paragraphs. Most journals, it's 4 to 6 paragraphs, 1,200 words. It's kind of the standard, like plant cells and PMI, plant genotype thing. So it's very easy. You have 4 or 6 paragraphs. Just decide. Paragraph 1, I'm going to talk about this. Paragraph 2, about that, etc. And then the first and last paragraphs are the easiest ones, usually. For me, the first paragraph starts with the biological question, the problem, the unknown. So that's your opening paragraph. You start with the question, and then you get to the background. And then you finish by summarizing what the findings are. So The last paragraph is the one that usually has a statement, in this study we did this, we discovered that. In general terms, without too much detail, it just gives a preview of what the findings are. Again, because you're not writing a mystery novel, you won't tell the readers immediately what the findings are. Don't be worried about that. Don't think like you have to hide until the last moment. It should be really obvious to the readers what the findings are, what the point of doing all this is. Otherwise, they're just going to struggle with your paper if you don't do it. Okay, a little tip just for you is when you finish outlining the introduction, and again, I would really outline the introduction before writing it, go back to the results section by section, look at your figures and your results, and make sure that everything is covered, okay, in the introduction. For example, if the paper has AVR3A suppressors in form, you might be focused on effectors, RXLI effectors, AVR3, etc. You might realize you actually did not introduce what INF1 is, right? So if you go back to your figure and look what are the major players there, you might realize, hey, you know, I didn't actually introduce what INF1 is. So now you go back to your introduction and find a place, you know, to put in maybe a couple of sentences to introduce what INF1 is. So this is a nice tip. Once you're done with the outline introduction, go back and check it. Check the results section by section. Everything that's there, every topic that is important, really should be introduced even briefly in the introduction. Okay, now the discussion. The discussion is about the implications of your findings. Okay, so this is where you cover how your findings relate to previous knowledge and what it means for the future. Okay. So, and this is actually the most interesting and the most important part of any paper, really, because once you discover something, once you report the results, fine, okay, you have this data, but what does it mean? What does it mean, the big picture of things? And this is also, I think, really important. I think this is where reputations are made, in my view. It's in the discussion. I think when you start really reading the discussions of some papers, you realize, wow, this is really taking the field forward. This way you get really impressed by someone and think like this person is really taking the field forward and thinking in terms of what's next and kind of, you know, you have this wow moment when you read some discussions like, yeah, wow, this is really exciting and stuff like that, you know. I mean, I'm thinking of like a typical discussion point in this paper of Laurence and Stewart with Mark's group about the fact that one of the effectors are the two oligomerizers. I mean, this opens up all kind of implications and possibilities, right? Maybe that means in the future, maybe they form heterodimers, you know? And so maybe these effectors form heterodimers once they translocate. Maybe there's all kind of higher order of complexity, right? Now, that may or may not be true. This is all pure speculation. But that's something where, you know, imagine you put in your discussion, and 5 years later, this becomes like a major topic, right? I mean, that's where you really want to take the intellectual leadership in the field, exploit the discussion to basically look forward and say, this is where things are heading, and I think this actually might be a possibility. And if you're the first one to do it, you would be given the intellectual credit for actually pushing those ideas forward. So first paragraph, I usually start with a general summary of the findings. In general terms, you recap basically what was discovered. And another thing that's quite handy is when I get stuck with a discussion, I always say, okay, what is the question? I start with a question. And it's not actually a bad idea to start a paragraph with a question, like, why does nucleic alter the expression of plant genes? And then you turn the paragraph answering that question in terms of, you know, implications and so on. And to go back to this business of like future direction, I always like to get to the most famous paper in biology and the famous statement, which is a typical standard discussion thing, discussion statement where you want to really actually keep in your mind is this business of it has not escaped our notice. So this is the famous Watson-Crick paper. Of course, they found the double helix, they found the pairing, and this has not escaped their notice that this could be a mechanism of copying genetic material, right? So they don't have data about that. It's a speculative statement, but it's actually the most important part of the paper is that speculation that this could be because of the double helix. This could be a method for copying DNA, copying genetic material. So I never actually started with it has not escaped our notice, but I often think about it. You know, I often think about, gosh, it would be terrible if you write a paper, you have fantastic findings, and you're not actually the one to point out what the implications are. Right? Imagine they didn't do this. Right? They would have looked like idiots, really, because they have this fantastic data, but they actually did not realize what the implications of the data was, or did not actually state it. Incidentally, I kind of, this is an aside, but, you know, they also used other people's data, and they do say that in the paper, that they will publish it elsewhere, but actually it's not their data. That's something that, of course, is not acceptable, but, you know, they got famous for a discussion statement, really, more than anything, wasn't even their data. But that's for historians to sort out. Okay, so now the title, okay? So the title is, now we're at the end. Now we have everything written, basically. And now we start bothering about the title, and seriously, we start bothering seriously about the title in the abstract. So the title should be really informative. I think this is really important. The title should give some piece of knowledge that when people read it, they're actually learning something from it. It's not like, you know, functional characterization of gene X or something. That doesn't say anything. It just says that you are working on gene X. Okay, that's the only thing. And you published a paper on gene X. A useful title should really have a statement like, you know, gene X does this nasty thing to potatoes, right? And recently there was a tweet, I'm not going to tell you what the expletive was, but there was a fantastic tweet from a graduate student at Berkeley who says that a good title should end with an expletive. So if you say, for example, you know, functional genetics, functional characterization of gene X from Phytophthora, like, damn it, doesn't sound right. But if you say, gene X does this to plants, damn it, that's really good. I mean, so a good title should really, actually, should be able to put an exclamation mark at the end of the title, and people go like, wow, yes, that's a piece of information I want to know. So I thought that was actually a really cool rule, but you can ask me afterwards what the expletive is, I'm not going to say it. But the other thing about the title, and I really think this is really important, especially in this day and age where really a lot of people actually read your titles because of the internet and all that. In fact, I would say for 100 people that read the title, probably 10 will read the abstract, and maybe one will read the paper, maybe one. So maybe 100 times more people will actually read the title. And that's the only connection they will have with you and your work is through reading the title. But out of those, I would say less than 1% will actually read the paper. And probably out of the 1% that read the paper, like how many will actually read, for example, like the paper in great detail is probably another, I don't know, 10% of that or something. So the title is really important. So use it to basically promote your work, promote your science. Have some information in there and have something that if somebody would only read the title, they're actually learning something about your work. Okay, so the abstract is, for me, it's the last thing. I don't care about the abstracts. It's very easy. It's copy-paste. I don't write abstracts. I copy-paste them from the paper. And that's why I leave it to the end, because at that point, I would just go through the paper and highlight in red the why, what, and how, the answers to those questions. And actually, if you cannot do that, if it's not so easy for you to go and find, okay, this is the answer to why, this is the answer to what, this is the answer, then you're really in trouble because your paper is very poorly written, because then the answers to these questions have to be really obvious. And then I would just copy them from the main text into a document, organize them, and that's your abstract. So I wouldn't bother with more than that. You can just polish it, etc. But I would leave it at the last moment for two things. First, it's a waste of time to actually do it before, because you just have to write things twice. And secondly, because it forces you to go through the paper and make sure that the answers to these questions are there and are very clear in the paper. Okay, so the last part is writing skills. First of all, it's all about reading. Okay, so if you want to be a good writer, you have to read. So you can, I think you heard this in school, I think we all did. The more you read, the better writer you become. So read. And when you think you're done, do some more reading. I was told in grad school that one paper a day keeps the supervisor away, so I keep repeating that. So I would say, really, in average, that's what we should all be reading, at least one paper a day, I think, in average, of course. And why is this critical? Because for two reasons. First, you improve your writing skills, as we all know, by reading, especially if you're not a native speaker, you will just automatically develop a sense of what is correct, what is wrong, and what is good writing, what is bad writing. But also because your paper is really about building on previous knowledge. So you want to be very familiar with the literature to be able to say, what I actually have in my paper is something new. If you're not familiar with the literature, how can you say that? How can you actually be confident about writing good discussion, for instance, and saying that, yeah, this is what's been done, and this is what I'm proposing, or this is what the implication of what I found is. So you really have to have this very good knowledge of the literature if you want to be able to write a paper, and especially that introduction, the why, and also the discussion, even to frame the paper. So we never read enough, and we never get exposed to enough knowledge. Okay, this is just some ways of improving your writing. There's some really good books there. I really like this one. It's a handbook on writing skills. We have, I think, a few books in my lab. If any of you are curious, you can come over and check them. And read critically. So I like to do this. I have a file on my computer where I save like great sentences, you know, sentences that I really like. So I just copy paste them and save them. And it's really fun to actually go back to them once in a while and read them, because you get inspired by this really good writing. So read New York Times. It's a really good thing. It's still free, actually. Angela told me it's not free anymore, but actually there's ways around it. Just Google that. If you Google an article, if you access it through Google, then it's free, so it's fine. So anyways, and the New York Times is at least I like it because I find it actually to be closer to the scientific style of writing than the British papers, which tend to be sometimes too wordy. So it's a more simplified style, it's very concise, and it's to the point, and actually writing papers is like writing, it's like journalism really, it's like reporting actually, and I think I wish that in school I took actually journalism class, because I think there's lots of similarities in how you report a story to how you report a scientific story also in a paper. So the New York Times is good for, you know, getting yourself to have, if you read a lot of New York Times, I really think you should read one New York Times article a day, in my view, if you want to improve your writing. Then you will develop this sense of writing using that style, which is really important. And also I like it to basically discover nice examples. So I actually just go and search a word in the New York Times. Like, I was wondering once, I really want to say this, you know, phytophthora is arguably the most important. But how do you actually use arguably? So you just go and search arguably in the New York Times, you end up with 10 examples of sentences that use arguably, and because they have really good editors always used in the same proper style, then this was one I kind of copied and saved it in my sort of top sentences from out there, and then it's kind of nice. The same with centered. You say centered on, centered around, etc. If you have doubt about that, easy thing, go to the New York Times, search the word centered, and then you have many really great sentences using the word centered on. Whether or not, whether to, so just that's the same thing. So it's a good way of developing your writing skills. Just exploit what's out there in the internet. But if you use the New York Times, then you have a consistent style. If you use anything on the internet, then you would get sort of thrown in all kinds of directions. But if you use just the New York Times, then you would have one particular style that is always consistent, that you can sort of adopt basically as your writing style. So clarity is very important, less is more, that's very important. Structure, I really like that, making structure, subsections. Structure first before writing, make sure that it's logical, then write, you know. And then you can merge things, combine things, it doesn't matter, that you can always do that. And then another hint, which is a very useful tip actually, is to use the first sentence to introduce the paragraph to the reader. I think I go through some of these. This is structure, so this is actually an outline of a paper we published a long time ago in 2004. This was the introduction, so we first structured it like this. So intro is about that, this is one paragraph, this is the last paragraph, and this is part of that. And I have to say, like, this paper was written by Yawing Tian, who was a PhD student in my lab, and she's from China, and she's one of the most logical person I ever worked with. Really smart girl, very sharp, very clear mind, and her English skills were horrible. She could hardly write, you know, at that time at least, she could hardly write really proper sentence in English. But it was so easy to work with her on this paper, on her papers and her thesis, because everything was very well organized, very well structured, the flow was perfect, all the ideas were there. Really, all we need to do then was to convert it into, you know, readable and correct English, which actually these days you can just pay £200 and have some copy editing, first copy editor fix it. So that was easy. So again, the point here was not about writing skills. If she had like fantastic writing skills, but couldn't put the ideas together and couldn't organize them in a logical way, it would have been much, much more painful. And so the point is this first, structuring it, putting things in logical order, then writing it. Okay, so this is the first sentence to introduce the paragraph, so this is examples to find out, to do this, we did that kind of thing. Discussion starting with a question, like I said before, why does Phytophthora have 65 copies of this gene, and then the whole paragraph can now basically answer that question. So when you start with, again, when you start with that, then it makes it a lot easier on the reader. They know what you're going to talk about. If, you know, they don't care about this topic, they skip it. If you keep this sentence at the end, or this, like, compared to other homages, Phytophthora has an unusual number of copies of this gene. If you start with this, then it's very clear for the reader what you would be talking about. Then you can spend the whole paragraph discussing why Phytophthora has more genes, gene X, more copies of gene X than whatever. But if you, like, the mistake that is frequently or frequently observed is this is kept to the last sentence of the paragraph. You finish by saying, it's compared to... So that's not very useful. So it's not very, like, really, you're not being very friendly to the readers. You're just keeping this to the last, and that's not very good. Okay, alright, this thing about plagiarize, I think this is usually the most contentious thing I say, but I really, really believe in plagiarizing yourself. Okay, I think it's a waste of time in science not to do that, because there's really no reason why you should write 500 times why Phytophthora is an important pathogen of potato. Right? It's the point of science is not to do creative literature, it's to communicate. And once you have certain sentences that are properly written, there's absolutely no reason, no valid reason why you should not be able to copy them, as long as it's your own writing, right? So I believe in this, I fight for this forever. It's very controversial out there in the internet if you go look at it, but I think it's a total waste of time for scientists to spend their time sort of finding 100 ways of writing why Phytophthora is an important pathogen of potatoes rather than doing the science. So I see Jonathan nodding there, so...
analogy came to mind,
similar
like playing chess, so it's like you're required to
come to
a new opening every time.
Oh, right, yeah, so it's like playing chess. Mm-hmm. Okay, yeah. Yeah, Jonathan's making the comparison here with chess, where every time you would make new opening, you're kind of forced to make new opening rather than using the same classic openings. Yeah, good point, yeah. But anyways, so plagiarism is about copying someone's work without their authorization, okay? So if I'm your group leader and I tell you, I'm a co-author on your paper, and I say, yes, it's okay to copy my text, then please, by all means, do it, because I'm not going to sit there and correct, like, for the 100th time, a sentence about why Phytophthora is important, you know, something like that, since missing a bunch of things, etc., right? So I truly believe in that. It's important to be efficient in this business. And so I say, yes, please go and self-plagiarize yourself, or self-plagiarize me if I say it's okay. And one very typical example is with figure lessons. So you often publish the same experiments, obviously, multiple times for, you know, with different things, like, let's say, a Western blot or a co-IP. So the figure lesson of that, it should be really standard. Just go to a note paper, it can point you to that, tell you, like, just, this is a very good, well-written paper that we published, and use that as a template for your experiment. I don't want you to just start from scratch and you know, make something that's completely scrambled and just don't want to. I don't have the patience to go and correct that for the emptiest time. So I think self-plagiarizing is okay in science, maybe not in other endeavors. Okay, so. Good writing also is about, not about good writing, is about good editing. So everyone will tell you that. To be a good writer, you have to be a good editor. So you write your first draft, then you have to be able to go back and edit. This is why actually reading is so important for improving your writing skills. It's not going to improve your writing skills initially, but it's going to improve your ability to edit your writing, because you will have a sense of what is wrong, what is right, what is properly written, what is not. So it's, if you want to be a good writer, you want to become a good editor, and you have to be able to also edit your text and emotionally, and not feel like, oh, I wrote this, so I don't want to mess with it. No, you have to be able to have a clear mind and look at it and say, this sentence is really messed up, and this is really not clear, and be able to edit it. So if you want to be a good writer, that means you're going to be really good at editing what you see. So it's very useful also to read other people writing. If you have someone else in your lab is writing paper or something, get to read that stuff and do it seriously. It's not to read quickly and find like, oh, there's a typo here, there's a typo there. It's about reading every sentence and thinking whether it makes sense or not, whether it's well constructed or not, whether it's clear or not, whether there's information missing. This is all the editing, and it's tough work. It's really hard work. You really have to focus very hard. You have to be, it's draining. I find it very draining. I cannot do like more than a few hours a day of this, otherwise I just get really tired. So it's hard work, but that's something you really have to become good at if you want to be a good writer. So find, you know, weed out bad sentences, learn to simplify them. You know, shorter is better. If it's too long, break it into two sentences. Less is more. There's a simple rule. If you can delete it, do it. So edit. Okay, three rules I don't mess with. This is from the old presentation, but I still believe in this. In my view, the result should always be in a simple past tense. We hybridize. Don't get complicated with English. I know some people say, no, we have done this, we have to write have. I just use simple past tense. Okay. In many cases, it's probably grammatically incorrect, but I don't care about that. We're communicating science here. So it's simpler than having drafts where, you know, you have things that are written in the present tense, past tense. This gets too complicated. So let's make it simple. Results always in the past tense. And this is the tradition. I mean, the tradition says that published knowledge is already accepted because it's published, so it should be written in the present tense. So the introduction pretty much should all be in the present tense because you're describing what is known, accepted scientific knowledge. But the results is not actually published yet since you're writing it, so it should be in the past tense because it's not published yet. But once it's published in the next paper, you can present it as present tense. So this is the kind of standard thing I was taught in grad school, and it's just a very simple thing. So and frankly, if you're editing, you should be able to find this. You know, I hear it when I get stuff, and then the results are in the present tense. What have you done? You haven't read what you wrote, then, obviously. Because it should be pretty easy to pick up that this sentence is written in the present tense if you're reading it carefully, and not in the past tense. And then I heard the passive voice. Sorry, those of you from Germany, Holland. This is really, I think the passive voice is a very ambiguous way of presenting information. I would just say we did not expect this rather than it was not expected. Just avoid it. And really, you could sometimes harden the methods. I'm tolerant of the methods. And a lot of papers we publish in the methods are in the passive voice. But really, there is no reason to use the passive voice in most cases. I just say we did this and that's it. Okay, so it's a little late, but I'll wrapping soon. Dealing with editors' reviews, your papers will be rejected, so get used to it. It will happen, but rejections can be challenged, and well, reviewers are not the enemy, so I'd sort of not be too emotional about it. Although I think some people are, but anyway. So actually, you know, rejections can be challenged. This is the message I want to have here. So don't be too down on yourself. Your paper is rejected. Try to think about it in a clear way. Maybe wait a few days, read the reviews again, and try to see if you can actually address them seriously using scientific arguments, logical arguments. If you can do that, you may have a shot at convincing the editor. And I love this one statement that somebody showed once at the conference. So what's the difference between diplomat and editor? So always keep that in mind. The diplomat says yes when they mean maybe, maybe when they mean no, and the diplomat never says no. But an editor says no when they mean maybe, so that's when you get rejections, actually maybe. And they say maybe when they mean yes, but an editor never says yes. So keep that in mind. When you get a maybe, it's probably yes. When you get a no, it's maybe a maybe. Okay, so that's it. Happy writing, happy publishing. Look forward to reading your papers, although I'll probably only read the titles.